and welcome back to another episode of the Malia Kimball Show. I'm your host, Malia Kimball, and over the last couple of weeks, me and my friend Jayla have been talking about a couple of things that we want to do and a couple of places that we want to go over the summer. So we decided to make a summer bucket list and list down the things that we want to do for the summer. So what I would like you guys to do is comment under the video and tell me what you guys would like to do or where you guys would like to go during the summer. And please don't forget to subscribe and hit the like button. Well, next, I have a great show lined up for you guys, but right now I have a performance from Spiritual CHU, so let's go.
Okay. A mustard seed is about this small. Yeah. I know a lot of y'all gonna get it twisted. This is the lyrical version of gospel music, quite hysterical. Spirit hyphen CHU, Christ has us. Can't even sit down and have church. They might blast us. Never worry about my pastor. He's never gassed up. You mad or not? I'm putting God in my raps, brother. Enemy don't want none of this. I resist. Once I say my father's name, watch him dip like a let up off a clip. What would make him think he'd jump up off a cliff? After Judas realized he played God and made him sick. Father, Abba, that's my father. You gotta respect him. Check him, baby. Bloom and blossom. Gordon play possum. I ain't the one to gossip. But I could teach you about the gospel. Out the ghetto, dropping jewels like apostles. I'm fired up for him. True or D. Best believe. If you hungry, all you need is the faith of a mustard seed. Yeah, yeah. If it's anything dealing with God, if it's anything dealing with faith, if it's anything dealing with spirit, you know, really, I ain't got time to waste. Y'all can go ahead with all that I'm for delivering. You know, once the storm's been with it, what'll make your whole body shiver? That's the Holy Ghost. Holy, yo, the Holy Spirit, don't. Had a conversation with him about the Pope. You think Jesus is a joke? Here to give the people hope. In the midst of all this hell, some got them gasoline drawers and they soap. Got his eye on his barrel, but your finger on the trigger. There's a bullet in the barrel, sell your soul to squeeze the trigger. Russian roulette, now what did you expect from a beautiful angel made out of instruments? Would take your last breath through a black life matter. You prefer dark meat. Got the fever for the flavor for this tall black sheep. Oh, you up so little. Faith. Pick up the cross, you've been double crossed, mate, by the enemy estate. Like a hunter, make you bleed for these 5 miles to feed. Tell my youngest all they need is the faith of a mustard seed. Yeah, I got to have it. If it's anything dealing with faith, if it's anything dealing with spirit, you know, really, I ain't got time to waste. Mustard seed, that's all you need to have faith in God. And you can see him if you truly believe. My young people, give your life to God. Check it. I done fell in love with Jesus. It's my season for his grace and favor. Honor thy father, honor thy mother, and respect your neighbor. Truth of the matter is, a lot of bruised and battered kids. How sad it is, don't even know they make them. That's how bad it is. Why you burning sage? You really know what you be practicing? All sorts of spirits and demons you reenacted with. Get off that. Get on your knees and get you some get back. Quit playing them games, X and O's. You lost tic-tac-toe, bro. Them chicks on Instagram photos. The new millennium to watch porno. Come on, walk with me slow. Talk to me, baby. The gift from God to cast out demons is crazy. I must confess, before I was blessed, the late days was on my mind. I had to repent in fidelity. Pick up the LG eternally, I'm doing my deeds. What everybody needs. Faith of a mustard seed. Okay, faith of a mustard. If it's anything dealing with God, if it's anything dealing with faith, if it's anything dealing with spirit, you know, really, I ain't got time to waste. Mustard seed. That's all you need to have faith in God. And you can see him if you truly believe. My young people, give your life to God. Life to God. Mustard seed. Mustard seed. Mustard seed. Mustard seed. Mustard seed. Thank you, thank you.
Okay, guys, welcome. So for my first guest, I have the privilege to be interviewing somebody that I grew up in the church with, who's practically like my brother, Nicholas Bartel. Hi, welcome.
Hi, thank you for having me. Good, how about you?
Okay, so for my audience and my viewers, can you tell them a little bit about yourself?
Yes, my name is Nick Bartel. I'm a senior at U of D Jesuit. I'm graduating this year. I'm 17 years old. I've been in Elam since I was 10 years old. And yeah.
Okay. So as a technician, I know at school it's a lot of different things, especially at my school, it's like different cultures and everything. How did you, when you first got to high school, how did you adapt to that new environment?
I would definitely say at first it was hard to adapt to that environment because with U of D as a private school, so there are so many people coming from different areas. So with that comes different cultures, different races, different backgrounds. And I think the biggest one for me was definitely the difference of religions, because what I believe, it may not be what someone else believes, and kind of having to find a common ground in that.
Okay. And since you go to Elam, can you tell them what your role at Elam is?
Yes. So I work with the media team, and I also help with the youth church sometimes.
Sometimes. So how does that go?
With the youth church or the media team?
Youth church.
The youth church, sometimes it can be a little wild. Sometimes it can be very calm and collective. It kind of depends on the day and how the kids are feeling at that day.
Okay. And with the media team, did you always want to be a part of the media team, or was it like a role that was just like assigned to you?
It was never assigned to me. I was asked to do it, and I kind of was open to learning about it. And then as I started to do it, I started to like it more and more.
And since you're a senior, can you tell them a little bit about what the senior year has been like for you?
I'm going to be honest. I'm not going to sit here and say senior year is a walk in the park. It definitely is difficult. But with senior year, it matures you, because now you start having to think like, okay, I have to make decisions without mom and dad with me. Okay, where am I going to be in a year? So I think senior year is definitely, if you look at it from the right perspective, it's a big learning experience.
Okay. And back in like 2018, me and you both went on a mission trip to the Philippines. So can you tell the audience a little bit about what you remember from the trip?
I remember just kind of like what we discussed earlier, embracing and seeing a completely different culture. And it also made me, you know, appreciate even the smaller things that we have that they didn't have there. So I definitely just remember being, like, astonished at the difference in culture and things that I do that they don't do, or things that they do and I don't do.
Okay. And since senior year is almost over and you're about to go to college, do you feel like you're prepared?
I don't know if I feel like I'm prepared. However, I'm trusting in my faith. Like, you know, I know God is going to be with me throughout it. But I feel like no one can ever truly say they're completely prepared for college, because you don't know what will be. Everybody has a different experience. So you don't know what's going to be thrown at you. But having, you know, faith in God and like, okay, even though I don't know where I'm going, he knows, it'll help you through.
Mm-hmm. And with you going to college, have you thought about any future careers that you plan on going into?
Yes, I have. I'm stuck between two careers right now, actually. I'm thinking about going either into the medical field or into, like, business, marketing, kind of advertising.
Okay. And what college are you planning on going to?
I can't tell y'all yet. We got decision day next week.
Stay tuned, guys. So, in school, did you play any sports, or were you a part of any academic organizations?
Yes. So, I am, as of right now, I am an e-board member of BASE, which is Black Awareness Society of Education. And that it is a group for Black students in U of D, because U of D, like I said, is different cultures. It kind of gives us a safe space to feel like where if we feel like something is wrong or there's racial issues in the world, we can sit there and discuss it. I've been doing that. I've been a part of the club since I was a freshman. However, I've become an e-board member this senior year. And I've tried out for swim, track, kind of dibble and dabble just a little bit.
Okay. And with your plans in the future, how have you made your connection with God stronger so that he's with you throughout your entire journey in life?
Trust. I would say, like, at first, looking through all the colleges and seeing my friends getting acceptances and all these things and trying to decide, I fell back on my trust. And that was a time where I found it very difficult to kind of navigate. But however, I feel like trusting him is what's gonna.
And since you're a part of the media team, what is, like, something that was difficult to you when you first started and that now that you're really good at?
I would say staying focused, like, being on cameras or being in the back room. There's so much going on with praise and worship. You have to listen, trying to listen to the sermon, trying to see what's going on in the church. But then you also have somebody in your ear. So definitely, like, trying to remain focused on what you're trying to do.
And since we're speaking on church, do you have any plans of becoming a deacon or a pastor or anything?
I honestly do not know. Wherever, if God calls me to do it, I will, but I don't know right now. I'll do some praying on that.
Okay. And also, recently, your mom was on my show, and she talked about homeschooling. Yes. Was that ever a thought in your mind to be homeschooled?
It was. However, back in the time where I was thinking it really wasn't available to me because both of my parents were working. But it never, like, it would cross my mind just a little bit, like, oh, I don't feel like waking up for school tomorrow. But I know I can wake up at 10 a.m. and do homeschool. So that's kind of how it was. But it never really crossed my mind.
Okay. And you have younger siblings?
Yes.
So what is, like, your biggest thing when you see that your younger siblings are looking at you as this, like, big role model? What is something that helps you set a good example for them?
Just kind of thinking about them in everything that I do. Like, if I feel like, okay, I try to think of if my little brother sees me right now, what would he think or how would he feel? If my little brother hears me say this, what would he think? How would he feel? So I kind of try to do everything to, I always keep them in mind and being an example.
Okay. And when you were a freshman, what is something that you thought was a real, like, big deal that now as a senior that you was like, that you're just like, it's not that big of a deal?
I'm going to be honest, like, trying to be friends with everyone. Like, and not saying that you can't have friends, but trying to be like, oh, everyone likes me. That it, you're going to find yourself in a lot of situations trying to do that and losing yourself and trying to do that.
And what motivates you? Because I know, like, for some kids, like, waking up every Sunday to go to church, you may not be feeling it all the time, but what motivates you to come to church?
I used to be that kid that didn't want to go to church. Sometimes I still am that kid that doesn't want to go to church. But my mom, every time I say, like, I don't want to go to church or I don't feel like it today, she always says the same thing. And she said, like, if you don't feel like it or you're tired or you're upset, that is the day that you need to go. And there's a reason for that.
Okay. And do you have any work experience?
Yes, plenty of it. I've worked in the restaurant industry at different restaurants since I was 14.
And since you've been working at a young age, what was that like?
It was difficult at first trying to balance school and work, especially being younger and trying to be organized, but it definitely gave me more organization skills and kind of better planning. Like, okay, I know I have work today, but I know I have a test tomorrow, so I need to study now. So things like that.
Okay. And what is a couple of tips you have for underclassmen who may be struggling with focusing on school or maybe, like, relationships with their friends?
As far as struggling with your work through school, I know this is going to sound hard, but try not to procrastinate. And I know every school gives a planner. Use it. It will be your best friend. And as far as friends go, a real friend, you know, is when you get there, you know, you can tell them anything and not feel judged. It shouldn't be, okay, well, I don't want to do this because I don't want to make them mad. No matter what, even if you guys get into arguments, friends argue, friends have disagreements. A real friend is when you can sit there and come back and get it together. Like, for example, this past weekend, me and my friend had a disagreement. We sat, we were at school, like, the next period we came back and was like, are we serious? Are we doing this? Like, that's a real friend.
Okay. Well, I want to thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. Well, we'll be right back after this with our next set of guests. Hey guys, welcome back. So for my next guest, unfortunately, Pastor Rodell is not available, but we have someone better. We have his sister, Pastor Nell Prentice. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. That's it's good. My wildest dream to imagine sit here on a talk show with you.
Yeah.
So this is over the top, but I'm glad to be here.
Okay. And for my audience and my viewers, can you tell them a little bit about yourself?
Sure, a little bit. I'm Pastor Nell Prentice. I am Pastor Rodell's older sister. And I currently live in Georgetown, Texas. That's outside of Austin. You know, we were born and raised in the Philippines. You know, I'm a mom, a grandma, and a gym rat. And I love God with all my heart. So I'm happy to be here. Just really thrilled to see you grow up. You know, you visited us when we were in the Philippines. So this is amazing. So I'm really happy to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. So how did you first decide that you wanted to become a pastor?
You know, it's amazing because that's something that I don't think I decided. You know, when I was growing up, Malia, believe it or not, I am probably 10 times or more shyer than, you know, the shyest person you could ever imagine. I'm the kind of person that I want to be invisible. I want to be in the back and all that. So it wasn't my greatest aspiration to stand on stage or anything like that. I don't even want, like, my pictures taken, you know. But I believe when I got born again and I got saved and filled with the Holy Spirit, which was a game changer for my life, and I just so love God. And I pursued God with all my heart, you know, and over time I served at our church. You know, I really believe in serving is the best way of honoring God in your life. And it's just that pursuit of the Lord and His Word and trying to know who I am in Christ Jesus. And I believe that through all of that and being staying in the local church, you know, the local church is really where, if you are serious about serving God, that's really where God sets you to develop and find your calling. So it's really good that you stay in a local church. This is where you figure out for yourself, you know, this is the place where God will develop your gifts. And that's what I did. I started serving in the nursery. I started, you know, that not having an aspiration to be a pastor. But in the kingdom of God, faithfulness is really the key to God moving you upwards, because faithfulness shows that God can trust you with more things and more things. And so when I realized that, you know, God revealed to me that there's more for me in that aspect. It wasn't like I wanting to, you know, stand in a pulpit. No, it's just I wanted to share with people how God helped me, how God changed my life, and in that fire in me to share, to help people, you know, change their lives, and that, you know, for them to be reconciled to God. In those steps that God really put me in a place wherein I could minister to more people, you know, each and every day. You know, when you have a desire to do that, I do believe that God puts that desire in your heart and then puts you in a place where that desire could be expressed and help other people. It's all about helping other people in the kingdom of God. And that's kind of how the journey is. It wasn't like I was born and I was, you know, thinking about, I want to be a pastor. It's the farthest from my dream. You know, I want to be invisible. That's what I wanted to be. I don't want to be in front of people. But the Holy Spirit is really the game changer for boldness, you know? And it's wonderful. It's a wonderful journey.
It is. So you talk about being from the Philippines. So what was the transition like coming from the Philippines and then coming to America?
Well, you know, that's a great question, because what happened was when I was in the Philippines, you know, growing up, we weren't really, I didn't know God a whole lot in the way I know him now. I wasn't born again. And the best and wonderful thing is I got born again in August of 83, got filled with the Holy Ghost, and went to the United States in September of 83. And I was a single mom with a six-year-old daughter. And, you know, it was like, you know, being thrown out there in the middle of the ocean. And but the best part of it is that I was, I'm born again. I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. I didn't know a whole lot, but I had the Holy Ghost in me. I had a helper, you know. And Jesus said that in John 16, he says, it is to your advantage if I go to the Father, because then he'll send the helper. So I came in here, you know, not really being even able to speak fluent English, you know, but I had an advantage. That's the advantage, was the Holy Spirit. And it's really, I came here with a suitcase and like $40, a six-year-old daughter, and my living Bible. And God took me far because, you know, I had the advantage in me. And the Holy Spirit just led me from, you know, from here, where to stay, where to go, where to get the job and all that. The whole transition, I believe, could have been very difficult. Because I've seen, you know, I have relatives that migrated here. I know friends that migrated here. And their journey is a little bit more difficult in terms of when there were disappointment, when there, you know, it's hard to transition from one culture to the other, just even learning the language, even learning the way they do things in the U.S. And some of them, you know, had some setbacks, you know, maybe fell into drugs and addictions and stuff like that to be able to cope in the new environment that they're in. So I am just so grateful that I had gotten born again and filled with the Holy Spirit, because I came to the U.S. as an immigrant with an advantage, and that's the Holy Ghost.
Okay. And as a pastor, what are some challenges that you face, and how do you overcome those challenges?
Well, whether you're a pastor or not, challenges will be there. Jesus said in John 16, the last verse, he said, in this world, you'll have tribulations, you know, but he said, be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. And he said in the Amplified Classic, he said, I have deprived the world of its power to harm you. So I do believe that when we know what's been offered to us, when we know what is in us, which is 1 John 4:4, greater is he that is in us than he that's in the world. When we know those things, you know, challenges are always going to be there, but it's what you know that takes you over the challenge. So it doesn't overcome you, but you overcome them. God intended for us to overcome every challenge. In 1 John 5:4, it says, and this is the victory that overcomes the world. The challenges are in the world, but this is, we have victory over that. And that is our faith. And so we stick to our faith. We can overcome any challenge. There's challenges in being a pastor. There's challenges in being you. There's challenges in being in high school, in being a mom, in being a grandmother, in being married. There's all those challenges, you know. And what we need to know is that challenges are always going to be there, but our faith is the victory that helps us overcome the challenges. As pastors, you know, probably one of the hardest thing is when you see people are not practicing or not applying the Word of God in their lives, and you know that it can help them. You know, sometimes I feel like if I could just, like, cut their head and pour everything I know in their head so that they could, you know, overcome this challenge. But, you know, when it comes down to it, people are going to live their life according to how they want to make a decision in that. And as a pastor, you stand back and you know they're making the wrong decision, making the wrong move. And probably that's the hardest part, because, you know, you cannot transgress people's will. And even though, you know, I mean, not even God violates your will, you know. So that's probably the hardest thing, because I love people. You know, that's the thing about being a pastor. It's like you have such a love for the sheep. And that's the hardest part. And I'm sure you know that if you, you know, someone that's, you know, not doing it right and stuff, and they're going the wrong way, and you just like cry for them. That's kind of probably the hardest challenge as a pastor.
Okay. And when it comes to being a Christian and living a righteous life, what are some things that you do to make sure that you're staying the course and living a righteous life?
That's a great question. I'm telling you, you're just going to be a great talk show host. You're beautiful. You're smart. So anyway, and you have God. You have Jesus in you. So anyway, to stay on course, you have to stay in the Word of God. You have to stay, you know, live full. You know, we don't have to live half empty every day. If you do, that's just your choice. You know, it's how much you pursue God. You got to live full of the Holy Ghost. You have to live full of His Word, you know, and that's the, that's how you stay on course. And also stay connected with the people that God connected you with. Stay connected with your church. Stay connected with your pastor. Because the devil's going to try so hard to take you out of the place where God had set you. And to be, why? Because he wants to take you off course. You know, and so you want to honor those things that God connected you with. We need people. That's why it's called the body of Christ. We need the other people that God connected us in the body of Christ. So stay connected in your church. You know, the devil's going to try to make you feel offended so people leave and stuff. But, you know, stay connected. That's how I've always done it, is that I stay connected with who God divinely connected me with. And I stay in the Word every day. You know, I read my Bible every day. I study it as much as I can. And I speak the Word of God. I have some confessions I confess over myself of who I am in Christ Jesus. You know, you just kind of have to, those things are, I renew my mind with the Word of God. You know, renewing your mind according to the Word of God, that's a daily thing that we should do. You know, and just looking at the Word of God every day, because that's the mirror of who you really are. There's so many things, Malia, in this world that will tell you, suggest to you that you're not this, you're not that. You should be this, you should be that. You know, there's so many things in this world that are like, going to give those suggestions in your head, but the mirror of who you really are is in the scriptures. You know, I always say people like to go to Google and try to find out, diagnose or whatever. You need to go to the epistles, because that's where who you are in Christ Jesus. That's where you need to camp. That's where you need to live. That's why you need to feed on, are the epistles. And if you do that, you know, It's not really that difficult to stay on the course where God called you. So.
And I know you have a book. Can you share a little bit about your book?
Oh, yes. This is something that God had put in my heart back in 2006. The book is called From Mistress to Minister, because that really is my life. When I was 16 years, it's my memoir. And when I was 16 years old, you know, I told a lie to my mother that caused me, you know, to change my life, got into some bad company, bad friends, and it changed the trajectory of my life. And at age 16, you know, I just got into some really downhill things, and it ended up to be a from 16 till I was 24 when I got born again. So that's like 8 years of a life of depression, a life of just a life of being abused and verbally, physically abused. It's not an ideal life. And you know, I was a single mom. I got pregnant at 17. And, you know, and this is in the 70s, Malia, but there's no Google, there's no Oprah on TV or Dr. Phil. This is like pure figure it out, you know. So, and I was a 16-year-old, unlike a 16-year-old now. I mean, you know, 16-year-old in the Philippines, they were just so naive to don't know what you know, what you're going to do. And so I had to process everything that had happened to me. I was raped, you know, all that at 16. I had to process all of this in me. And this is what's all in the book on how God, you know, can change your life from that, you know, from being, and I became someone's mistress, you know, and change the trajectory of my life. Like I said, when I got born again, got filled with the Holy Spirit, who is the Holy Spirit is the game changer of life, you know. He's the member of the Godhead that's on the earth. He's our helper. And you know what? And Jesus did not even start his ministry until he got baptized in the Holy Spirit. If Jesus needs the Holy Spirit, we need the Holy Spirit every day. And that really what changed the trajectory of my life. And I became from mistress to a minister and telling people, hey, there is hope. You know, when I was 16, that happened to me. And I came home. I remember I was pregnant. I came home with a baby, you know, and I looked at that baby and I thought, my life is over. You know, I couldn't see this day. We're in my family. I have a beautiful family. I have a beautiful life. Thank you, Lord. Glory to God for all that. But I couldn't see that day. And that's what's all in the book. It will help you. It will help you get have hope that no matter how deep a pit the devil put you in, there is hope. In God, there is hope in the Holy Spirit. And they're both willing to help in Christ Jesus to get you out of that pit. And that's what the book is about. It's a book of to give you hope and a future, you know, in the Lord. And you know, I just hope. I wrote it because a lot of people asked me before, did you write this? So it's just some sort of healing stuff. I said, God already healed me of all that. There's no residual effect of all of that happened to me. And that's because the Holy Ghost burned it all up in me. You know, it's like Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego went into the fire and came out not even smelling. That could happen to you with no residual effect of the trauma that I've been through. And I believe that the book will help people to do that. You know, it's not a cathartic experience that I want to put in a book. No, it's the Holy Ghost gave me that title, helped me write that book. I prayed for that book when God put it in my heart. I prayed for it for like, I don't know, 2 years, and it took like 3 months to do it. And that's because it's in there and just God brought it out. And it's really all to the glory of God, of how God can change your life beyond your wildest dream.
And if anyone wants to get the book, how can they find it?
Believe it or not, it's still on Amazon. It's still on Amazon. And I always tell people, after you read it, give it to somebody else, you know, like a tract, because it will help somebody, you know, it will help somebody that has no hope, you know. And, you know, you talk about that time in the book when I was in my 16, 17, 18, till I was 23, you know, I was, you know, suicidal, suffered depression, you know, just full-blown alcoholic, you know. I didn't know how to cope with all of that. And you have to go to the world, what the world says will help you ease it, but it doesn't really help you ease it and stuff. But, you know, there's hope in Jesus, and the only hope, true hope you need, and the only answer is really in Christ Jesus. So that's what the book is about. It's still available in Amazon, you know. If you have it, pass it on. Amen. Somebody might need it. You never know.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And for my last question, do you have any advice for teenagers my age?
Oh, yes. I've raised teenagers. I have a grandson. My oldest grandson is now a teenager. You know what? Live a life that honors God and pursues God. And I'm telling you, it's the best life you could ever live. Jeremiah 29:11, he said, God says, I know my thoughts about you. I have a plan for your life, a plan for a good future, not to harm you. You know, the answers, a lot of our youth and young people has a lot of questions, you know. And so you could go to all the places where people try. You could go to a bookstore, go to social media, go to Google. But I'm telling you, go to the Bible. And the Bible, oh, that's just my grandma reads that. No. The Bible is for everybody. Everybody that can read. You'll find the real answers, the truth, in a world where it's just littered with deception. You want to get hold of a Bible, get an easy translation if you want. You know, get plugged into a church. First and foremost, receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior first. And ask Him to come into your heart and say, Father, I come to You in Jesus' name. And Jesus, take my life and do something with it. I give You my life. I give You my heart. Do something about my life. And watch what God is going to do about your life. But you have to give it, and then receive the life He has for you. And it's going to be the best life. You know, a lot of people, a lot of books, they offer live your best life. Your best life is in Christ Jesus and nothing else. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for taking time out of your day to come.
Oh, thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you.
You are on your road to bigger and better things.
Thank you.
I am so happy for you and thrilled for you.
Thank you.
Keep up the good work.
I will. Thank
you. All right.
So thank you guys for tuning in. Make sure you guys like, comment, and subscribe, and stay tuned for the next video.